Hello friends, today we are going to speak about active tolerance. Let me introduce the topic to you first. Tolerance comes from the Latin word tolerare, that means to bear or endure. As the word suggests, it is regarding an attitude or behavior in social sphere where one has to put up with something which is not acceptable but which cannot be aggressively rejected. Throughout the history of mankind, the concept of tolerance has been used in the religious and cultural space with impact on the political. Tolerance is best understood when it is compared to intolerance. Reaction to some religious, cultural, or ethnic behavior in an aggressive or violent manner is intolerance. Any other expression of behavior which is short of intolerance is understood as tolerance. It is a wide spectrum where some forward movement is to be inspired. Mankind has conscience and a thinking mind, so the autonomy of a mind must be respected. Everyone cannot be on the same plane, so the need of tolerance is significant. There is a history to the concept of tolerance, but there have been no major changes to the basic idea of toleration since the 18th century. In the 20th century, the United Nations internationalized the tradition of rights to toleration. Article 18 of Universal Declaration of Human Rights says toleration and tolerance have the same connotation by and large, as both appeal to the attitude of adjustment. Ever since, the idea of tolerance has undergone evolution. This may be traced to November 16, 1995, when the United Nations Educational, Social and Cultural Organization, that is UNESCO, issued a Declaration of Moral Principles of Tolerance, signed by 185 member countries in Paris, France. It was an effort towards more flexible and open-minded approach. It made tolerance into a moral, political, and a legal qualification for individuals, organizations, or groups and states. The emphasis here was on warm embrace, not just acceptance. Before this initiative, the word tolerance was understood to be anywhere between persecution and warm embrace. If tolerance is understood in this sense, it will be active tolerance. Active tolerance includes the idea of promoting tolerance amongst people. Tolerance is not indulgence, nor is it indifference. Tolerance recognizes the fine balance between the fundamental freedom of persons and their human rights. Learning outcome. Let us see the learning outcome of this module. In this module, we have understood the spectrum within which tolerance has evolved and how an approach towards active tolerance is a necessity now. Starting from the historical beginnings of attitude of tolerance, to its becoming a recognized feature of a mature democracy, its place in political and religious thought, and its description by various thinkers, this module gives a clear insight on active tolerance. Tolerance can only be active every passing day, as both the context and agents have to negotiate with each other to make it effective. Tolerance and its valence. The concept of active tolerance is further enhanced when the valence of the word tolerance is described. In the liberal context, tolerance will have a positive valence, but in an oppressive regime, this very tolerance will be said to have a negative valence. Repressive tolerance can mean tolerating an oppressive regime or oppressive activities. British rule over India is an example of repressive tolerance. Interestingly, there may be an instance of tolerating a protesting voice to avoid its recognition. For example, the voices of social reformers were initially met with such a treatment before making a place for themselves. In a social and political context, the situation of class inequality could have conditions of repressive tolerance. The tolerance preached by Gandhi is to keep high the values of mutual respect for differences that may lead to conflict. The non-cooperation movement started by Gandhi against the British could be built on observing the principles of tolerance. Truth, non-violence, and justice are made relevant only by achieving a tolerant mind. Tolerance is so crucial that its violation leads to fanaticism that is against the spirit of humanity. According to Gandhi, we cannot deal with our opponent till we do not understand his idea. This understanding needs tolerance. Intolerance is violence to intellect, just as hatred is violence to heart. To be able to avoid the paradox of being tolerant of the intolerant, we need to look at the nuances of the concept of tolerance propagated in a given situation. Toleration entails the need to respect what others are doing, but we must analyze if the action done is respectable or not. It is a misnomer that tolerance will blur the line of distinction between right and wrong or good and evil. The clarity of truth will enhance the ability of tolerance. Some concepts are worthy of examination to promote tolerance. If religion is one of the most widely known cause of intolerance, it could be analyzed to propagate peace as well. All major living religions of the world have been preaching ways of living with peace and harmony. In the 17th century, Spinoza had written about the freedom of thought, arguing that the protection must be given by the state against a mob and the state must be reined in matters of religious conflict. Some related concepts like patience, modesty, charity, and humility might also help in promoting the role of tolerance in a civil society. Tolerance is not always based on principles, though it is largely based on principles. Sometimes it is a result of practical considerations too. The desire for political stability and sheer exhaustion from the ongoing state of affairs could also be a ground of tolerance. Some economic gains that are crucial for well-being of the people may also become a ground of tolerance. After all, the political is affected by the economic state of affairs and vice versa. Thomas Erastus, a Swiss physician and a theologian associated with Erastianism, implying state supremacy, advocated that hostility does not pay, so tolerance must be enforced by the state. Prohibitive orders like gag orders and decrees passed to control contending sides and their debates in order to reach some speck of tolerance must be permissible. The conflict could be based on anything related to human sphere, also religion. As far as the principles are concerned, they need to be carefully examined, as persecution is also justified on principles. Freedom of thought and rights of conscience are the foundations of a tolerant society. Both Thomas Hobbes and John Locke have subscribed to the idea of tolerance, though both have been political philosophers. Commenting on powers of the state, the role of state is closely governed by the attitude towards tolerance it may be asked to show. For Hobbes, tolerance is in the interest of the ruler, and for Locke, tolerance must be recognized for its political gains. The philosophical principles are potent in giving strength to reasons for tolerance. The principles of equality, impartiality, principles of fairness and justice, principles of liberty, autonomy of the mind, are central to issues of tolerance. Critical thinking and reasoning can help us decide what is necessary and what is contingent. To consider Fichte, no one has a right against reason. Men are uncomfortable in giving up their subjectivity. They are more comfortable with tradition and arbitrariness. The tradition can often be misunderstood or be mythical in nature, so the role of reason is important for us to analyze the next course of action. The ignorant man needs to be guided by wisdom, and wisdom is in accordance with reason. But it is not possible for the uneducated to understand reason immediately, hence the need of guidance, whereby it may seem that the freedom is being restrained, but actually it is not. The negative liberty is regarding freedom to do things in one's own way in certain areas of one's life, and positive liberty is about a source who can control or interfere in other agents' life to ask him to be this instead of that. Tolerance is possible if we can understand the operation of these two concepts of liberty. Actually, tolerance can be a part of political theory, as a moral concept is being used here to make it applicable in the political sphere. Just as freedom is measured by referring to the ideas of obedience and coercion, tolerance can be evaluated by the play of confirmation and coercion. How much is one accepted in his being the way he is, and how much is one made to change by force? The idea of unlimited freedom is not possible, as it would lead to chaos. So liberty has to operate with some agreeable restraints. The concept of tolerance is a necessity for a civilization to flourish. Plato had named four cardinal virtues: justice, wisdom, temperance, and courage. The virtue of temperance has tolerance as a desirable element. Temperance was to be exhibited by the masses, as they were not as accomplished as the philosopher ruler or the auxiliary class of soldiers. Of course, the ruler shows the virtue of wisdom, and the soldiers showed the virtue of courage. Virtue of justice is in each segment performing their function with efficiency. The ideal society, as envisioned by Plato, makes a space for temperance. The ideal social structure must have some form of practiced tolerance, which you can call active tolerance, to avoid being prey to other forms of governance that are against the freedom to live democratically. The idea of active tolerance is about making efforts to bring tolerance in the activity of people for the betterment of society. The people may not be aware of the role of tolerance, so sometimes even forcing them to remain tolerant may also be required. This is not compromising with the political right of a set of people, rather it is for the development in time that they will realize the importance of such a step being taken. The political rights granted to citizens of a state are not compromised if some restraint is practiced in order to preserve the higher values of justice, equality, or economic prosperity. The inability to do something is not recognized as a ground of tolerance. For example, a poor man unable to meet his educational needs shows restraint is not a tolerant man, he's a helpless man. But tolerance is showing restraint when it is in my power to do things otherwise, but I do it so as to have it done for myself. A poor man certainly requires access to basic needs before looking for concept of tolerance. Nonetheless, his claim on a tolerant response from others and his tolerance towards others are equal. Just like freedom, tolerance is also a demand for everyone worthy of reason. There are conservative thinkers and liberal thinkers where both sides keep on deliberating over how much to let go of. The idea of centralized control against individual freedom is a point of debate. So far, it has been agreed that some area of personal space should be kept out of centralized or state control. Benjamin Constant, a Swiss-French political activist of the 18th century, said that the sphere of religion, property, opinions, expressions must be preserved and any mighty invasion should be resisted by force. Mill, a libertarian, felt that without liberty, society would not have individuals of genius, intelligence, or some mental energy for new thoughts. Mediocrity slips in such a civilization in itself a doom. For Mill, just as liberty should operate in a sense of negative liberty, perhaps tolerance also should be operative in a passive way. But in today's time, the fine line between the active tolerance and passive tolerance is to be evolved with the context in hand. Sometimes discipline shows desired results too. There are views from both the sides, but to reach an appropriate course of action, one may have to analyze the context. The Gandhian view is that of active tolerance, where we need to assign self-disciplinary ways to people to cultivate in them a spirit of tolerance. The followers of ahimsa or non-violence must develop the soul force to have the strength of tolerance in adversity. This soul force is developed through a regime of self-disciplinary life without which one would not be a true follower of ahimsa or non-violence. Before we set out for the goal, we are not aware of the achievements that certain type of discipline can result in, but once we reach it, we continue to make it more refined as its value can be realized only through its practice. Freedom is basic to realization of this kind of life. This freedom rests in tolerance, at least in this case. For Kant, also, freedom lies in resisting unattainable desires by controlling oneself. A free self is trained to understand the importance of desires that must be controlled because they are not attainable. Active tolerance is propagated by Kant in trying to make people develop a rational, which supports this approach. The highest value is that of a human being. His autonomy must be respected. Thus, the idea of tolerance is linked to the practice of autonomy of a human being. The freedom of one and many is operational due to the tolerance shown by others. Active tolerance involves elimination of irrational fears and desires. Social life needs to be understood from various perspectives. It is an interaction between different groups and the nature. History of human social life is equally important, yet we cannot say that human social sphere can be perfectly harmonized by giving some political or social law that will not change with time. Institutions that govern social life must be understood. Real freedom lies in understanding the social fabric from the past to the present, thus having a vision for future. Institutions run on a rational. If this rational is misunderstood, the character of institution will also change, resulting in failure of achieving its goal. Marx felt that men made social institutions, but in course of time, they were misconceived, changed their character, and became obstacles in the progress of their creators. He himself understood the reason behind it. Mankind can substitute the social institutions with a progressive one only when they realize that such institutions were a result of need and circumstances of the times they were made in, and man made them. Principles and reasons behind them can thus be substituted. It is a fundamental error to think of such institutions of the past as irreplaceable, as humans are not static. Times and need both will change, and so should the rationale according to the times. Marx also felt that rules do not oppress if I impose those rules on myself. Real freedom is in understanding. The idea of active tolerance can be found here too, as it is about the steps one must take to let the higher values become functional. To have a law obeyed consciously is to find it a rational law. That is the mark of rational law, that it cannot be both why and not why. Just to oppose a law, even if it looks rational, is being unreasonable. Tolerance is best understood in its positioning as a rational ground between extremes. Understanding of social forces and rational basis shall make active tolerance more cogent. Tolerance follows some events that have happened in the past. It comes at the second stage. It has limitation. Understanding of the past is important for genuine tolerance to occur. Cultures and people have to be analyzed to have tolerance. The moral nature of the past events carries the potential of future. Tolerance by itself is not a virtue. It becomes a virtue when practiced in a genuine way on grounds of truth. Tolerance must be accompanied by virtues of courage, wisdom, and care. The dynamism has to continue. It becomes a vice if any social evil is accepted in the name of tolerance. All human beings have an intrinsic value, so tolerance is based on this principle. It must not override the truth related to the intrinsic value of all humans. Tolerance, just for the sake of the principle itself, may not give desirable result, for it may encourage unacceptable behavior of the intolerant people. Let us see the approach towards active tolerance, how it can be achieved. There may be, generally speaking, tolerance in the field of race, religion, sex, society, and thought. The more these factors are aligned to the idea of truth about themselves, the better tolerance a society can achieve. To teach active tolerance, we need to create awareness about each one of them. The role of education, the practice to uphold the spirit of recognizing shortcomings and designing ways of eliminating them, is a part of active tolerance. Some of the ways are: creating teamwork, which can make diversity more acceptable. Designing policies to remove prejudices and discrimination thereafter. Making civil society more mature by not reacting to hate speech. Strengthening the legal institutions to ensure equality and justice for all. Making outreach modules and awareness programs to safeguard the ethnic cultural groups so as to have a compatible surrounding. The steps need to be taken because neglect of an idea can have a compound effect in the long run, which could take a violent form if not handled with care. Critical thought performs the function of giving an idea its due place so that before a rational may look insufficient to present-day affairs, some synergy may be forged for the betterment of society. Rousseau said, "The nature of things does not madden us, only ill will does." Even the intention to interfere in the lives of other human beings so as to frustrate his desires is impinging on his freedom. The oppression of this kind is also a problem. The more freedom we want, the more we have to be watchful of interference coming from other people. Tolerance requires sacrifice of some freedom, but the sacrifice should result in increase of some higher values. A system asking for tolerance of the majority to enhance the progress of a few is an unjust and an immoral system. But if some tolerance can promote justice and equality, it should be acceptable in spite of some restraint on freedom. This sacrifice of freedom is the active part of tolerance. To be able to achieve mastery over one's own self so as to resist action that is detrimental to the spirit of justice or equality or discrimination. The idea rests on a truth. Discussions must be held on the idea for the rational to come out so that one truth works out better than the rest. The power of active tolerance has been suggested by Marcuse and Spinoza, where the desire to affect and to get affected has been suggested. Active tolerance seeks to empower an approach that recognizes the limits and inefficiencies of the existing condition and make way for new ideas to appear to make things happen in a new way. The conception of good that each side possesses has to be analyzed and understood, creating space and create conditions for gradual changes in it. The conception of the good may be different for different agents as it depends on belief, public culture, and many other factors that affect people. Active tolerance needs to create momentum for getting affected and affect. In a progressive democratic politics, active tolerance is more powerful if it can resist forces of repression and inequality. Tolerance in a passive way may yield a force that continues to accept the condition of repression and inequality. The dialogue may be required to let the forces show their effect. The respect for the other is acceptable till a reasonable limit. Reaching for it is everyone's right. Without communicating about the ideologies, we cannot understand the chances of conflict, and active tolerance has a role to play in avoiding conflict on rational basis. Socrates understood this fact and gave a lot of importance to dialogue and communication to expose the rational behind any belief. Active and reasonable tolerance is the only way to resist any intolerance. It urges us to get out of our ideological acceptance without reasoning about it. There are so many issues that are about societal choices. We need to organize discussions on them, explore whether the ideas need to be reinvented and change equation of the affect and the affected. This often involves issues that spark controversy and trigger anger, but the dialogue must be held in the spirit of active tolerance. The relations between people, state, organizations, all should be reviewed, and the truth must be sought after. Let us come to the relation between tolerance and the concept of good. The unique concept of good is also explored. The good has an intrinsic value that cannot be reduced to natural properties or to practical properties. The finding for truth will incorporate this understanding of the good. If a given concept does not abide by either the truth or the good in the sense of a recognized intrinsic value, it must be resisted without fearing allegations of being intolerant. The efforts in this direction have emerged in the concept of active citizenship. The role of active citizenship requires an attitude amongst the citizens to augment the function of democratic and pluralistic society. Since information, attitude, expertise, approach, all are to be aligned, almost all sections of civil society need to study the concept of active citizenship to be a functional part of it. If the interaction through active citizenship on informed basis is not encouraged, there will be a sense of fear, insecurity, and confusion. This situation is best suited for radical extremists to make their presence felt. There is a direct relationship between active citizenship and active tolerance. The institutions that are of meaning and influence must be alert towards their goal of being a voice of support in matters relating to pluralistic and democratic worth. The model of active citizenship could be named in West Germany, especially in city-states like Bremen, where strong official and institutional support is given to establish a competent system of democratic and legal structure. The Scandinavian countries, Norway, Sweden, Finland, are also strong on active citizenship. Romans have a maxim that expresses the idea around tolerance impressively by saying that if one is a human being, he should consider nothing which is human as alien to him or her. But it is also known that theory and practice have been at quite a gap, even in the Roman history. The French practiced tolerance more in the religious context initially, till it arrived at the modern interpretation of tolerance. Tolerance has a positive polarity to it, now as compared to the negative connotation of intolerance. The freedom that is necessary to nurture tolerance is the most important aspect of various ingredients that are included in it, like being kind, patient, generous, having an open mind, and being liberal. Active tolerance is about negotiation with the surroundings, with the other, seeing the practical consequence as well. It has to be placed in the context of existing legal demand and the practical requirement. A dialogue has to continue in language to make it possible. Let us know something about the idea of tolerance in the Quran, the holy book of Islam. The book is a result of revelations, is not debated at all. The problem lies in interpretations of whatever has been said and its impact on the relations between men of different communities. Islam talks about mercy. Rehma, 79 occurrences in the Quran have been spotted. Justice and equality. The commandments have been directed to man, El Insan, in 45 chapters out of 114, as well as humans, En Nas, on 245 occasions. Man may be free to be religious believer or not be one, for he is alone responsible for his actions and would be answerable to the God. There is no suggestion, not even a hint, of any restrictions or violence. There shall be no compulsion of religion. The right course has become clear from wrong. So whoever disbelieves in Taghut and believes in Allah has grasped the most trustworthy handhold with no break in it. And Allah is hearing and knowing. This is from Quran number 2, 256. The Prophet has left behind a reservoir of sayings from where one can take inspiration to do the most appropriate action. There are more than 2,000 sayings. Regarding tolerance, the Prophet has asked to show equality and kindness and preach about the submission that is expected of a Muslim. There is no space for an intolerant behavior between humans. The behavior instigated to show intolerance is a matter of wrong leadership. Active tolerance must take into account all such contingencies and devise ways of dealing with it. Communicating about the reasonable interpretation can dispel myths, fears, and illusions. Question is, what should be taken as reasonable? There must be a necessity of understanding, and if this necessity is not answered, views must continue to get analyzed. If it is a spiritual sphere, its knowledge must liberate at all levels. The social, personal, and political cannot be completely in opposition of what is inherent in the true knowledge. Unreasonable fears and desires must be identified. We must recognize the relative validity of our belief, yet be able to explain it for the time being to make it comprehensible. Sooner or later, if the belief is to be changed on further exposure, it may be after some examination. To quote Sophocles, "Do not think only you are wise, and you can think and speak like no one else." The Indians have been known to be tolerant in their past. Even before the Christian era, the ancient legislatures like Manu, Yagvalk, Kautilya were of the view that the king should respect the customs and traditions of its people and win the hearts of its people. This was displayed during the rule of Emperor Akbar, who used to hold meetings with representatives from all groups of society to encourage exchange of ideas. He abandoned the discriminatory practices as well. In the Western world, the norm was more of the dominant kind, where the religion of the ruler was automatically deemed to be the religion of the people. The contemporary of Buddhism, the Jaina tradition, also held non-violence and tolerance close to their teachings in the form of theory of Anekantvad, the reality is more than one, in fact plural, and theory of Syadvad, that is the doctrine of perhaps. The truth of tolerance is also the same to a large extent. The Chinese philosopher Confucius, who was mostly traveling, also described tolerance as part of the virtue of humanity. His saying, "Do not do to others what you do not want them to do to you," is in the direction of enriching human relations based on virtues of deference, tolerance, and faithfulness to one's word, diligence, and generosity. The word ren in Chinese is translated as humanity. Confucius wanted men to be treated according to their capability, but with the virtues that nourish humanity. To be equal does not mean to be entrusted with things beyond one's capability. Everyone must follow the social rituals according to the notion of ren. Perfection will slowly be achieved in understanding the subtle connection between the world of humans and the universe. There are forces that interplay with each other to establish a harmony. Opposites complement each other, so nothing is to be discarded. The idea of inclusion is central to the philosophy of Confucius. Tolerance, therefore, is to be practiced to give result to the interpersonal relationships to reach the truth of life. Usually, intolerance is found in all those places where truth is absent. Understanding of a situation is based on true knowledge. True knowledge consists in knowing the interplay of forces between the microcosm and the macrocosm. Let us see the conclusion. Whenever the virtues of humanity are explained, tolerance is definitely a part of it. The notion of active tolerance can be understood to be an enhanced form of tolerance. All virtues are alive till they are practiced and refined in an individual and in the collective. The social customs must be based on these virtues. The five cardinal virtues, deference, tolerance, faithful to one's words, diligence, and generosity, are at interplay, and their proportion has to be understood through various stages in life situation. This whole sphere is dynamic. The principle of active tolerance is therefore a good effort in the direction of giving the idea a positive valence. The active part is an effort to deal with dynamic features of social relations. Any silence or inert approach may destroy the ideal in the mind of a virtue-oriented humanity. The concepts of freedom, liberty, and autonomy are to be balanced out in order to accommodate the understanding of active tolerance. To conclude, it is well defined by now that tolerance has been an important factor in any religious or cultural truth-laden philosophy. We have to understand the meaning of a social situation and relate it with the truths that can activate the feature of tolerance amongst us. History must be looked at from this point of view. The lessons must help in drawing a picture that not only looks calm, but also is based on genuine postulates of being calm. The dynamism of active tolerance is about achieving this ideal. Religion, politics, society, and culture, all must be made to align with the idea of active tolerance. These are features of humanity, and they must be nourished on virtues as befits the idea of tolerance as well. Without active tolerance, the pictures of virtue is incomplete. I hope that this module is informative and it has been helpful as well. Thank you.